Prelude to Isaac. As the first president of Isaac, I'm delighted to introduce you to our production team. Penny Parnes, who was the third president of Isaac, Judy Seligman-Wine, who was the first chair of the board of directors of Isaac, and Lynette Norris, who was the first president of Isaac Canada and also served on the board of directors of Isaac. We've been working with colleagues and friends from the 70s and connecting with each other to reminisce about the days before Isaac was born. In a strange way, COVID's partly responsible for this film. COVID that's enabled the Bliss iBand to transition from having sessions in person every week to making movies.
My name is Aaron Lightstone. I'm the music director of the Bliss iBand for the last many years. And it is our distinct pleasure and our delight to provide the accompaniment to this overture. We hope that you enjoy our music, and we wish you an exciting time together in Isaac's first online conference.
This is the Bliss iBand when we had in-person sessions. Now you're going to learn why Isaac had to have an I for international in its name. Our story begins with a group of colleagues, seven of us who worked in non-speech in Toronto. And we began by sharing our memories of the old days, and it quickly grew to include a large number of international colleagues sharing all of our experiences. Everyone had a story. Our reminiscing led us to the themes for Prelude to Isaac. The first is connecting. It was the extensive connecting between the Bliss trailblazers in the 70s that brought about their strong involvement in the two non-speech conferences held in Toronto in 1980 and 82, and in the meeting in East Lansing, Michigan, where Isaac was born in 1983. In 1971, first with our Toronto interdisciplinary team, assisted by many talented volunteers, and connecting with our students, who proudly called themselves our guinea pigs. The first country to connect with Canada was the United States, and a doctor from the Netherlands learned about Bliss from a conference there. The second was United Kingdom, and the leaders there took Bliss to Zimbabwe and Portugal. The next country was Israel in 1974. Judy Wine gave leadership there, moving from Canada to Israel. Next country was Sweden, and from Sweden it went to all the Nordic countries. Then Australia in 1978. New Zealand in 1979 with Joan Hurren and myself giving a workshop there. In 1980, Bliss went to India. Also in 1980, to Italy. And to Bermuda, with Penny Parnes giving a workshop there. In 1981, Switzerland gave leadership to Bliss in France, Belgium, and Spain. And in 1982, Anne Warwick gave a workshop in Guam for both Taiwan and Guam. Margareta Janisch describes connecting the best.
It was in 1978, and I visited Canada in Toronto. I went to a presenter's training there, and it was most exciting. And I met people from all the world. So I met Jane Green, who was a principal in Newfoundland, and Bert Reeves, who was a principal at a school in New Zealand. And then there was another speech pathologist from UK, and I came from Sweden, and we had the most exciting time together.
And now the Bliss iBand is going to take you to innovating, playing with a little help from my friends.
I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. How do I feel at the end of the day?
Are you sad because you're on your own?
No, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends. I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends.
Do you need anybody?
I need somebody to love. Certain that it happens all the time.
What do you see when you turn out the light?
I can't tell you, but I know it's mine. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends.
The 1970s and early 80s were dynamic times. There was a sense of freedom that engulfed us. In our professional workplaces around the world, the concept of accountability had not yet reared its difficult head. We could spend as much time as warranted with our clients and their families.
We seemed to have time to teach bliss, to teach symbols, to teach strategies.
And in many parts of the world, the communication needs of people who were non-speaking became a focal point. We were innovative in so many ways. My move to Israel required the combining of bliss symbols in the right to left direction according to the written language. Others in other countries had to make changes to adapt to cultural and religious needs. It was a time when we went from seeing the person with a physical disability as having a multitude of fragmented needs as to seeing the person in a holistic manner. We as speech pathologists were surprised to realize that we were not only responsible for the child's speech, but also for his positioning so that he could access his communication tools.
As an OT, I was particularly interested in accessing symbols. I was introduced to the ETRAN frame and eye coding.
My first encounter with an ETRAN, which was through Mark Beasley. Spending a day with Mark around ETRANs, not really having a clue what they were, and switches and various things. I mean, she was quite the genius.
Device development was beginning long before professional technology was available to us by people from different countries with different professional backgrounds.
I was a student at Case Institute of Technology in Cleveland, and we were asked to make a communication device by another SLP there. It was our first product in the AAC area.
The systems that were then available didn't seem to encourage people to look at each other. So I developed what I call the talking brooch.
I'm a linguist and a computer scientist, and in the computer science department at Michigan State University, I set up the artificial language lab to pursue technological solutions for people with communication problems.
I was an undergraduate student in electrical engineering. Together, we formed a group of students to start trying to develop something. So we just kept going and going from there.
I am a psychologist. This is the Bliss Talk, which was developed at the Royal Institute of Technology, first in Swedish and then in English and French, from the IPCAS project, where we found hundreds of development projects, including some on symbolic languages for people with speech impairments. And that project started in 1975.
And I was an early developer of electronic augmentative communication devices. In 1970, I met six young boys with cerebral palsy. There was just something in their eyes that convinced me that they were really smart. I did my master's thesis to produce the Tufts Interactive Communicator. We called it the TIC. It was an early row-column single-switch scanning device.
Another development was Gompher.
Gompher was really cutting-edge software developed in the 1970s, long before the existence of email. It enabled people in different locations to text with one another via the computer in real time. In the early 1980s, Gompher was used by professionals who were interested in non-speech communication internationally to communicate with each other.
The excitement of all these people wanting to work together, together with the interactive abilities provided by Gompher, were driving forces in enabling the field of AAC.
That went before. I know I'll often stop and think about them. In my life, I love you more.
Has shared the excitement from the innovating that was taking place around the world. In 1971, at the Crippled Children's Center in Toronto, we discovered the huge impact of this innovation through our Bliss Symbol classes. We documented, collaborated with, and learned from local and international colleagues, from family members, and most of all, our discoveries and learning came from our students. Materials were developed to document progress, to share information, and new ways of communicating were taught at universities. There was a willingness to cross disciplines and to work collaboratively. Learning from each other and sharing our expertise gave us a greater appreciation of each student's unique needs and an increased ability to address their needs. Many people remember this as a magical time of connecting, innovating, and discovering. Jeff Iles discovered a connection between independent mobility and communication.
We began to realize that kids that were given independent mobility in a powered wheelchair improved in their communication skills and their ability to drive, ability to control an interface, remarkably.
Sophia Kelman observed a father-daughter situation and discovered a powerful model of intervention.
In 1982, the Ontario Crippled Children's Center father, sitting with his young daughter, communication book with her, having a lively discussion, the father present with his child, which at that time in our country, unimaginable. It was a turning point.
Alan Newell shared what we were all discovering.
It was also a characteristic either of the field or the people that worked in it, that we collaborated. Many other academic fields, they are a far more interesting competition, competing with each other to be top dog. Whereas this was never the case in AAC.
We shared discoveries with our students and their families. With their developing communication abilities, our students taught us about their resilience and their patience with society's inaccurate assumptions and lack of expectations. They taught us it was imperative they have a voice. Ziva shared her excitement discovering Jonathan viewed himself as a talking person.
When I see what he can write, it's unbelievable that someone who is not talking is actually talking. He is a talking person, which is fantastic.
With her Bliss abilities, Elaine discovered a new feeling of self-confidence.
Jane Green taught me Bliss later. I helped her teach Bliss at a workshop in Newfoundland at the university that made me very happy, and I discovered I could be a Bliss teacher.
Glynis, Carolyn's sister, discovered Carolyn's new communication abilities.
Carolyn couldn't really initiate or ask any questions. So with the Bliss symbols and the word board, she was able to ask questions. She could also start conversations. The symbols on the word board really helped her with learning and developing her communication skills.
From those who were non-speaking, who had gone before us, we discovered their own connecting and innovating. Christy Brown's My Left Foot, Joey Deacon's Tongue Tied, and Sue O'Dell, who was with us in the 70s, taught us so much. Much of what we discovered in those early days became the guiding principles, the values for our new organization in 1983, ISAC. If you just call me,
the time was one marked with many challenges and many reasons to celebrate and to be joyous. The 70s and early 80s led us through some activities which resulted in a set of very strong values related to the use of AAC. It was the worst of times.
In our speech therapy classes, we learned all about language, articulation, stuttering, voice, aphasia, but nowhere did we study about communication.
I was at the Belchertown State School in Massachusetts, and I took this job and got into a lot of trouble because I did some pretty bad things like take the children outside.
At the time, speech pathologists were being fired for using communication boards.
It was the best of times.
We were doing this new system, new ideas in a new building, and it was just a lovely, an exciting time for everybody.
But when I think about the team that we had and that would never go home at night and would spend weekends working, and we absolutely loved it.
That comes to me is expectations. I think what this introduction did is changed our expectations, our perspective, our understanding of what it is to be human.
We learned to value the cooperation among disciplines. We learned to work with people we had never worked with before. We broke down the silos between disciplines in order to advance non-speech communication.
Being able to draw on everybody's resources.
All together, we were teachers, assistants, physiotherapists, psychologists, OTs. We were all together and we had the same staff room, which was important, I think.
I'm a retired pediatric occupational therapist.
I moved to academia.
And I'm a clinician.
Basically, I am a pediatrician.
I was a rehabilitation engineer.
I'm a retired speech therapist.
I'm a rehab engineer.
I am a psychologist.
We learned and shared with each other across many parts of the world. They say it takes a village to raise a child. Well, it took the whole globe to advance AAC appropriately.
Many people came to Italy to share their experience. Judy, Benny.
Bill and I went to Bulawayo in Zimbabwe in 1982.
One of the earliest was Sudha Kaul from India. Sudha and others taught us that we couldn't address things just as they appeared in the West, but that we had to look at the implications for the majority world, which consisted primarily of those in low and middle income countries. We also learned that the world of the non-speech user was going to expand.
Nel 1977 è uscita una legge che aboliva le scuole speciali e tutti I bambini sono stati inseriti nelle scuole normali.
At that conference, this little girl, Louise, captured everybody's hearts because she was a great communicator. And I remember Anne Warwick calling her Miss Blabberthumb.
Paul Marshall traveled to 6 countries outside of North America and to many cities throughout Canada and the United States.
All these activities by individuals and institutions, both formal and informal, led to that momentous day in East Lansing in 1983, where at a meeting hosted by John Muhlenberg, Isaac was born and the term AAC was adopted. As you can see, this production involved many, many people. We want to thank them profusely for their participation. And for many, thank you for what you did in the 70s and the early 80s.
Bob Dylan got it right in the 1960s. The times, they were a-changing. And in the 70s, those changes began to include people who were unable to use their natural speech to communicate. In fact, the 1970s witnessed a sea change in how societies were treating people with disabilities and in the way people with disabilities were demanding to be treated. And that fight continues today. In 1975, I entered this emerging AAC field as a speech language clinician. 70% of the kids on my caseload had severe speech impairments. To say I was ill-prepared is a big understatement. Nevertheless, together with colleagues from multiple disciplines, we found ways to help all these children access language, ask questions, provide opinions, and make mischief. We called it total communication. In the early 1980s, I began meeting some of the people you just met on the video, wonderful people like Shirley and Penny and Lynette, Judy, and all the other beacons of excellence they interviewed. Thanks to each for taking the time to document Isaac's unique history, and thanks to the musicians who deepened the words spoken through the sounds of song. Of course, the Isaac story began years before that Boston conference, its first, in 1984. Shirley talked about connectivity, reaching across oceans, cultures, languages, and belief systems, finding new ways to share and discuss ideas, express our frustrations, and always to have a lot of fun. Judy spoke of innovation. Yes, we are problem solvers, embracing new ideas and approaches, exploring new technologies so people can communicate more effectively and have more choices. Lynette captured discovery, our shared compulsions to seek, ask questions, do research, write, and educate new generations. Penny reminds us of our core values to respect, empathize with, believe in, listen to, and learn from people who use AAC and each other, and to respect the mantra, nothing about us without us. So, what was in the 1970s a collection of mostly unconnected individuals responding to the needs of children and adults with limited speech, building technologies in labs and garages, fighting against systems that devalued and even abused people who were not able to talk, became the ongoing Isaac story. Dylan's lyrics resonate. The times, they are a-changin'. The old roads are rapidly aging. Please get out of the new one, meaning road, if you can't lend a hand. The times, they are a-changin'. The birth of Isaac connected continents and millions of eager hands together to make a difference. And of course, we're not done.